Hey everybody, it's Sue here for the first ever episode of Let's Play Community College, where I play games and we talk about something fun and educational and hopefully come away from it a little smarter than when we started. Today we're playing Cook Serve Delicious and we're talking about the Sovereign Citizens Movement. Cook Serve Delicious is a fast-action cooking game where you slap food silly with keyboard inputs to get it out the door as fast as you possibly can. A better title might be Mavis Beacon Teaches Health Code Violations. We're working with a platinum 5-star restaurant, and today we're serving beer, coffee, lasagna, salad, lobster, and enchiladas. We also have a date scheduled for the middle of the day, so you'll see me cooking for some lovely lady and responding to her text messages while all hell breaks loose in the restaurant around me. Now, what is the Sovereign Citizens Movement? I think the best way to answer that is to rewind a bit and talk about how constitutional law works. People sometimes say America is unique for having a written constitution. That's not entirely true. Written constitutions tend to be the norm, but some countries don't have them. You ask somebody from the United Kingdom to show you their constitution, and they'll point not to a single document, but to legislation, to the Magna Carta, to case law, to long-standing custom and precedent. Their constitution is what constitutes their government. We call this an uncodified constitution. In the United States, of course, we have a codified constitution, a document that's literally called the United States Constitution. Consists of 7 articles and 27 amendments, establishes the branches of government, what their powers and responsibilities are, the relationships between the states and the federal government, and so on. But it'd be misleading to refer to this document as our constitution in such a total sense, like we would with the United Kingdom. We may have a written document, but much of what gives it effect, what makes it actually useful, rather than impossibly vague, is a similar collection of case law, custom, legislation, and so on. It's why when someone expresses a political opinion that begins with, "Well, where in the Constitution does it say?" you can be pretty sure an uninformed mess is going to follow. The United States Constitution doesn't say a lot of things. It stays broad on most matters so that it can be applied to a changing world. You get the actual powers and restrictions of the government from the natural consequences of the different branches doing their jobs, passing laws, creating administrative agencies who create rules, the courts interpreting the Constitution. Now, this doesn't sit well with people who like to invoke the United States Constitution as this magical document, capable of striking down any law they don't like by way of a cursory Control-F search. Well, see, I searched the whole thing and the founders didn't say the word internet anywhere, so everything I do on the internet must be legal. Slow down. Sovereign citizens take that mindset to an amazing new extreme. These are people who treat the Constitution as if it literally is magic. They're basically the Dungeons and Dragons wizards of the legal world. If you wanted to invent a Greek word for it, I guess you could call them nomaturgists, similar to the existing word thaumaturgist, literally meaning miracle worker, but substituting the Greek root for law. These people treat the Constitution and the legal process like a kind of mysticism. Say the magic words, do the proper incantations and preparations, and boom, you are immune to the power of judges and police. You're a citizen of the states, or even of the world itself, living outside of a supposed contract to the federal government. Rather than being a citizen of the United States, you're a nation unto yourself, a free man on the land, a sovereign citizen. These people even borrow a page or two from demonology-type superstitions, believing that if the federal government fails to present your true name, well, they must be talking to someone else. They have no power over you. Your Honor, the arrest warrant said Bob Jones in all capital letters, but that's not my name. My name has only 2 capital letters. Other popular arguments include a belief that a certain flag must be placed in a court on this erroneous idea that a U.S. flag with fringe signals a maritime court of law, which wouldn't have jurisdiction for the average case against a sovereign citizen, because 99 out of 100 of these cases are about tax avoidance. The connection between sovereign citizens and wizards isn't just my own observation. This line of thought has apparently made it all the way to Canada as well. Canadian judge J.D. Rook said in an Alberta court decision that sovereign citizens, quote, engage in a court drama that is more akin to magic spell ritual than actual legal proceeding, and wait to see if the court is entranced and compliant. If not, the litigant returns home to scrutinize at what point the wrong incantation was uttered, an incorrectly prepared artifact waived or submitted, end quote. I want to take a minute to point out that the idea that a person should have to agree to a social contract between themselves and the government isn't all that crazy. In a liberal democracy, we like to talk about the idea that power derives from the consent of the governed. The term actually appears in the Declaration of Independence. But is the consent of rich landed whites in the 1780s binding over people today? Should it be? Thomas Jefferson wrote to James Madison in 1789 that he believed the Constitution should have to be ratified or rewritten every 19 years, and that anything else amounted to control over future generations exercised by the previous ones. He said, quote, "If it be enforced longer, it is an act of force, not of right." But Jefferson's ideas failed to carry the day, and there's a certain irony talking about this fuzzy gray area of right and wrong when we're talking about people who are so formalist that they are going to argue straight-faced that a court with the wrong kind of flag has no authority. Another classic Sovereign Citizen argument involves invoking Section 1-308 of the Uniform Commercial Code, and in particular the words without prejudice and under protest. Now, the UCC isn't even binding law. It's a set of laws put together by academics as a model for how commercial law should be constructed. It's offered to states as an example, and states are free to adopt as much or as little of the code as they want. Even if it were binding, it's about business transactions and has nothing to do with whether you need to pay your damn taxes. You do need to pay your damn taxes. The passage in question in 1-308 is about fulfilling the terms of a contract, but it's been seized on by sovereign citizens who take these words without prejudice or under protest and slap them onto all sorts of other things that have nothing to do with contracts, as if these are magic warding sigils that will strip police of the power to enter their property. You see it on so many hand-painted signs on somebody's borders, always with the hand-painted signs, these guys. They love them. Perhaps not surprising, the kinds of people who turn to sovereign citizen quackery are usually far right-wing, often affiliated with militias or tax protesters, and it kind of makes sense when you think about it. It assumes the existence of a law above the law, a law that's based on formalism and on X thus Y, something very black and white, not the muddy, difficult world of actual legal and political questions. We can hem and haw and talk about feelings and interpretations of case law, or what actually serves the cause of justice, or we can just say the proper incantations and draw a figurative chalk circle around ourselves to ward off Johnny Law. The unfortunate part is that caught up in all of this isn't just the wackadoos who think they're above the law, but a surprising number of ordinary folks who get scammed by sovereign citizen hucksters who sell these bogus legal theories at high cost, typically to retirees and people facing real financial trouble. It's a predatory scam, and if anyone you know sounds like they're falling for this stuff, you should be a friend to them and clue them in. The sad fact of it is that sovereign citizens really are like D&D wizards, but the only spell they can ever seem to cast is on themselves, and it's called imprison. And it looks like we got a perfect day here. Good job, us. That's it for this Let's Play Community College. Tell me what you think in the comments, and let me know if you'd like to see a specific game or talk topic. Thank you for watching.